Welcome to the third Fashion Film Festival, an event part of a research collective for the Decoloniar in Fashion annual general meeting. As you already know, I am Mimi Drado. I am part of the executive team and I am the festival curator. It's a pleasure to be here today with all, and I hope you enjoy the films that have been selected. It's important to share that the Fashion Film Festival aims to acknowledge a diversity of aesthetics and designs and gaze on fashion that goes beyond the Eurocentric American can of race, class, and the cisgender heteronormativity. So in a few minutes, we will watch fashion's polarity of definitions, geographies, generations, gender, sexualities, ethnicities, race, diasporas, and genealogies. Tonight, we have the honor of having Tamara Poblete from Chilean Colectiva Malvestidas as a moderator. Please, let's welcome Tamara.
Thank you, Mi. Voy a hablar en español al inicio porque es mi lenguaje materno. Así que me voy a presentar. Soy Tamara Poblete, un poco investigadora, un poco artista, un poco activista, con el respeto que los activistas me merecen. Actualmente soy candidata a doctora en Historia del Diseño por el Royal College of Art y también soy la segunda cabeza de una criatura extraña llamada Malvestidas, que es un colectivo interdisciplinario y feminista fundado en Chile el 2016. Okay, so now I'm going to speak in English. I wanted to do first in my own language, Spanish. I think it's an act of decolonialization as well, because as you know, language is a big problem, and I think it's at the center of all of these issues. I'm Tamara Poblete. I'm a little bit researcher, a little bit artist, a little bit activist, with the respect that activist people deserve. Currently, I'm a PhD candidate in History of Design at the Royal College of Art in London. I'm also co-founder of Colectivo Malvestidas, Poorly Dressed or Badly Dressed Collective, together with Loreto Martinez. This is an interdisciplinary, a feminist collective. I want to say thank you, Mi, for the invitation. She invited me after we have applied for the to be part of this festival, so I'm here with a double position. And I also want to say congratulations to the research collective for decoloniality and fashion. I want to say congratulations for your very commit, important, necessary work. I'm so happy to share this space also with the director. I really enjoy to watch all of the films. I suggest a specific order for today. So today, the first one is in Spanish because it's from Chile, Una editorial de moda en el basurero de la moda. A fashion editorial in the fashion garbage dump by Paula Contreras y Eric Lab, the director. The second one is Entangled, Enredado, from United States by, sorry my pronunciation, by Kaya Grujic. You can correct me later. The third one are two fashion films. The first one is To Fashion with the interview of Zulietti Fieme. And the second one is To Fashion with the interview of Fatima Sanusi from New Zealand. Fourth one, Relaciones from Peru. The fifth, Abraham Os Caminos in Portuguese. Clear the Way from Brazil, Mijo from Mexico, Transmutação do Feminismo, Transmutation of the Feminine, Brazil, and the last one is Semióticas de la Cultura, de la Costura, Semiotics of Sewing by Malvestidas. Before we start, I wanted to share a thinking, an idea. When I was watching the films, I start to think why they are fashion films and not just short films. Why fashion? And furthermore, after that, I thought, okay, fashion film, but why the colonial fashion film? So I would like to invite you now before watching the film to think about how fashion appear in the films and how the coloniality appear in the films, how they are present in these films. Hope you enjoy the films.
Al norte de Chile se ubica Alto Hospicio, comuna situada en el desierto de Tarapacá, delimitada por el frío océano Pacífico y la inmensa cordillera de los Andes. Su árido paraje, mundialmente destacado por ser un paraíso de la naturaleza en la tierra,
alberga las cenizas del que fue el vertedero de ropa más grande del mundo. La escena es distópica, una maniquí en un desolado panorama de oasis hecho cenizas, compuesto por residuos y desechos.
100% poliéster quemado, nube negra tóxica, irrespirable, tela sucia, desechada e incendiada que brilló en incontables ocasiones. Soy un vestido de 50 kilos de ropa usada, vieja, que fue encontrada acá, en el mismo desierto al que voy a ser olvidada. Llevo una tonelada en mí, vuelvo con las memorias de miles de mundos internos que yacen en tierra de nadie. Post-glamour, la moda en llamas. Donde los rucos que nadie sabe cómo sobreviven, crema Christian Dior con un poco de plata. Qué hermosa me veo, chica. 100% de descuento. Todo gratis.
Llévatelo antes de que otro lo encuentre.
We came into this world with eyes attuned to detail. A plant, a rock, a pile of dirt. We hold these things like the universe in the palm of our hand, or rather we cling to them, desperately trying to wield their power. Like Alice, we fall deeper and deeper down the rabbit hole. Some say we get caught up in the minutiae of life, that we fail to see the wood from the trees, and so the world passes us by like a picture in a frame. What if we perceive nature from within, in all of her forms, even those made of concrete, and looked around through the eyes of the wind? Now, the wood is no longer a series of plants, rocks, piles of dirt. Rather, in the twisting, gnarling, knotting of roots, we begin to move with its pulse. It is in this polyphony of breaths that the natural world is freed from the bondage of nouns, and rather reveals a verb. A plant buds into a flower, a rock hugs the shore, and a pile of dirt takes and gives life. To be human is to interweave oneself in this movement. To not know with certainty where one ends and the rest of the world begins. So no, we did not come into this world, but out of it, like a wave from the ocean, and into the air, once what seemed corporeal melted as breath into the wind. We are reminded that the water in our body is just visiting. It was a thunderstorm before, and it will be an ocean soon enough. We are more weather pattern than stone monument. And so, in our search for ways forward, our return into the woods is simultaneously a search for ourselves. Let us not simply care for nature then, but partner with it. Let us not reimagine it, but begin to imagine anew, with nature's entanglements as our co-conspirator, our partner, our comrade, and our guide.
Bright fella. I like bright fella. Not red. I don't like red. I think it's not suit me. But I like yellow. So it's a really bright yellow, like bumblebee yellow. All those color except red. I don't like red. That's why I don't really like go to the shop, because it's everybody go and buy the same thing with you. Perhaps better to make your own. And that's why you stand out. And that's why I like this, a very bright color, because it's when you walk over there, everybody can see you. Everybody can see you, and they can. And my mom have a sewing machine, and I think there's maybe two sewing machine in a village of three, I don't know, not many. And I asked him here, could I use your sewing machine to make my dress? And it's so beautiful, and I can imagine how I can make something for myself like that. But she said, I'm warning you to not. If the sewing machine is going to break down, we can't buy any. We have everything except money. But when my mom went up to the plantation with my dad, here I am coming in, got my dress, and I sew it up the sleeves, and I think this is thread this tangle, but you know, I don't understand. I just push harder. And this way, I sit over there and waiting for my mother to come in. And I get the bunnies, but the end of the day, I sit over there and sew by hand. And Sunday, I have a new dress to church. I never forget. I have a really big head, my bottom. You know, in Ireland, when you have something, you know, you really look after, because if you're not gonna have another thing like that, no, you have to really look after. And we, you know, we wear so many times. We just only wear on a white Sunday. And after that, maybe there's a Christmas time, we do some, you know, this, we do some Christmas something over there at church, then we wear this one. And when we finish that, we just only wash them and fold up and put on a pillowcase, close, waiting for the next time. When, because it's a, there's a special, you know, this special photo, and I have to wear my best. And that's a win, that's one over there. When I won this one before, when I get my honor from Queen Honor, she says only wear once.
That's good. All right, okay.
And I says only wear once. I'm gonna wear twice on the second time I wear Saturday. And I keep this one. That's my, because it's all my clothes I wear before this. Nothing like my niece gave it to me. This hair, she said, this eyes has only worn one, and I would like to give it to you to wear on this day. And I think she's a really, it seems for me to hear this like my daughter, this girl, that's my niece. And I like to wear this one because it's a special one. I just only wear once last year and I never touch it. I just only put on a pillowcase and leave over there. But now this on Saturday, I like to wear because it's a special for me on that day. And that's why I like to wear. And I wear my torn tawala in my tahuahilala. Because it's I like it. That's how I do, and then I respect. That's my I respect for my culture.
So growing up, it was really hard, and to be honest, in school, to embrace a Muslim identity. Not because I wasn't proud of my Muslim identity, but because I was around a lot of people that didn't understand it. This one time in high school, it was Ramadan, and I told my mom, okay, I'm gonna wear my scarf for this month. And I went to school. I remember the one of the few friends that I made, she was like, are you Muslim? And I actually took it off and I was like, no, my head is cold. And she was like, yeah, did you know Muslims do this and do that and bomb people? And I'm just there like, what? And you know, at that time I was like 15 years old and I wanted to fit in. That's how uncomfortable and scared I was to embrace my identity. I was too young to be firm in who I was and my identity, because I was still trying to figure that out too. So in 2017, I decided to go to Sudan for 1 year. It was really an overwhelming experience, a lot of different emotions, but it was definitely a breakthrough for me where I really found myself, and I guess it really cemented my purpose and what, and it really inspired all my creative endeavors coming out of Sudan. And I guess in that year, my whole purpose to go to Sudan was to understand my identity. And at that time, when I did decide to go to Sudan and seeing like just seeing a lot of people wear their scarf, like seeing that around me, seeing a lot of people that looked like me, I found it so beautiful. Like I honestly fell in love with the scarf. And I guess there was so much time that I didn't embrace that because I was afraid to. But being back home, it gave me confidence to be like, no, this is actually so beautiful. People just don't understand it. It's wearing my scarf, like the way I do wear it, really represents me as an African woman, not only a Muslim woman, but an African Black woman. And I think that's what definitely empowers me. I'm telling you, it's so hard to match your outfit with the scarf. And I guess it comes down to because your scarf also, you need to match it with your skin tone, not only with your clothes. Even like today, to be honest, like I put on a few headscarves to get it right. But usually I just pick my outfit out first and then I try to find a tone that complements it and complements my tone. So yeah. Okay, so the first time I wore a suit, I was actually 4 years old. And that was because I saw my father wearing a suit every day. Like he would literally go to the dairy across the road wearing a suit. My dad dressed my brother in suits. He would always dress him up in suits. My mom would dress me up in dresses, but I did not like the dresses. I cried one day and actually like begged my mom to let me wear a suit. And my dad eventually like was like, yeah, I'm going to let her wear a suit. And we actually went to a photo studio that same day he got me a suit. I remember him telling me, you know, you're going to look back at this photo one day and you're going to laugh. But I look back at that photo like, she knew. I'm actually wearing an Oromo necklace. Oromo is the indigenous tribe to Ethiopia. It's the biggest tribe in Ethiopia as well. They're actually facing a lot of brutality right now. They've been fighting for a long time. And my mom is Oromo, so I wanted to represent that today. My handbag, I got this from H&M. I was thinking, I was like, where did I get this from? So I got this from H&M. I actually just thought it was so cute and nice. And I needed to switch out my handbag. Like I've got actually like quite a lot of handbags. My mom inspired me because she would always have like a nice handbag, like all the time. She would wear a lot of different handbags. And she always told me that a woman always needs a good handbag. And I like the size, it fits like everything in it, you know, that I need today. And I like how it complements my look. My mom is my hero, literally, you know. My mom had to like stand in front of men with guns, you know, to protect me and my brother and my father in Ethiopia. My mother didn't have that strength, that courage, that resilience. God knows where we would be today, or where, if my father would have even made it to New Zealand. Our women, our refugee mothers, our migrant mothers, fathers, they don't get the credit that's due for how much they actually not only carry us, but carry the world, to be honest.
De maravillas, ¿no? Yo cuando era niño me acuerdo que le preguntaba a mi abuela, ¿por qué utilizas sombrero, abuelito? No, me decía, no, eso es que cuando vamos a trabajar nos protegemos esto y también me dice, me gusta el color, me gusta porque es mi personalidad, decía.
Por ejemplo, en mi caso, una de las abuelitas por parte de mi papá aún mantiene toda su vestimenta completa, con su sombrero y todo, ¿no? Entonces, yo te digo, no, ella sí, ella no ha sido netamente guaracina. Entonces sí ha venido de los alrededores, ya, pero prácticamente ya ha llevado más de 50 años acá, pero aún ella sigue con eso, sigue con sus sombreros, con sus polleras, con sus blusas coloridas. Entonces netamente guaracinos no los vas a encontrar con sombreros.
Y eso más que todo lo veo porque tengo familia, en especial mi mamá, que utiliza. A ella no le gusta, por ejemplo, las copas altas, Le parece muy exagerado, por decirlo así. Y solamente utilizan lo que siempre han utilizado. Claro que mi papá ya no utiliza mucho, porque como no hay esos sombreros que a él generalmente le gustaba, los chatos, ya no utiliza sino gorros nada más utiliza, ¿no? Pero mi mamá sí utiliza porque comúnmente hay todavía, pero son un poquito más caritas.
Había una señora, pues, muy importante para mí. Ella utilizaba pues ¿no? esta indumentaria, que era más como una abuelita, pues, ¿no? Entonces, el simple hecho de ser chiquita, pues no, yo no entendía esa situación. Entonces, el hecho de que ella quizás me toque o me roce con sus vestimentas, pues no, para mí era un poco extraño. Al ir creciendo, fui comprendiendo que es una manera, un estilo en el que ellas pueden expresar lo que sienten.
Pero las primas que yo tengo, o sea, las lejanas, no usan la vestimenta. Antes, como les digo, es por discriminación, ¿no? Porque sienten rechazo y eso no debería ser así. Pero sus papás, sus abuelitos o todo ese pueblo, el pueblo de mi mamá, donde viene, sí lo usan. Hasta ahora tú puedes encontrar gente, bastante gente.
Gracias. Eu antes não me sentia assim, animada, extrovertida. Entendeu? Hoje eu visto as minhas roupas, eu me sinto uma bela mulher, com força, com coragem.
Transmutações do feminino mudou não só minha autoestima, mas o meu jeito de pensar, o jeito de me vestir.
Hoje eu me sinto livre para fazer o que eu quero comigo mesma.
Eu acabei me descobrindo, me revendo e vi que eu sou linda.
Normal. Regulate. Polucionar. Pollute. Precarizar. Precarize. Desarraigar, unroot, herir, hurt, aislar, isolate. Imponer, impose, racializar, racialize. Homogeneizar, homogenize, traumar, traumatize, disciplinar. Disciplinary.
thank you to all of the directors for these films. Before watching the films, I invite you to think about how that fashion is presented in these films, and also how the coloniality is present in the film. So now I would like to share a thought that I had when I saw the film. I'm gonna read in Spanish first, and I'm gonna read after in English, especially because for people who English is not their first language, or for people that don't have a good root in English, it's very difficult to express ourselves and to feel ourselves in another language. La moda, respecto a la, about fashion, about how I see fashion in the films. La moda aparece en su ausencia, en la expectativa fallida de ver moda. La moda se nos presenta como crítica a la moda, al canon que se nos impone y que opera como una idea de proceso histórico, de concepción teórica, de lenguaje visual y de modo de producción y consumo. La moda se nos presenta como lo que excede a la moda, como eso que a veces la moda no nos deja entender, porque lo coapta, lo absorbe. Me refiero a la indumentaria como un objeto con agencia y a las prácticas de vestir como manifestaciones llenas de otros mundos. En ocasiones logramos ver la indumentaria y las prácticas de vestir únicamente cuando la moda desaparece. In English, fashion appears in its absence, in the failed expectation of seeing fashion. Fashion is presented to us as a critique of fashion, of the canon imposed on us, and operates as an idea of a historical process, theoretical conception, visual language, a mode of production and consumption. Fashion is presented to us as that which exceeds fashion, and sometimes fashion does not allow us to understand, because it co-opts it, absorbs it. I'm referring to clothing as an object with agency, and to the practice of dressing as manifestation full of other worlds. Sometimes we manage to see clothing and dress practice once fashion disappears. And now, decoloniality. La decolonialidad está, simplemente está. Y lo hace no como una opción, sino como un modo inevitable de existencia. Una existencia que siempre ha estado ahí, pero vaciada de sentido por la mirada moderno-colonial de la moda. Existencias que resisten y que reexisten. Lo que está en colisión no es la lucha entre la moda y una nueva moda, sino otros horizontes de sentido para relacionarnos con la indumentaria desde subjetividades que, como la ropa, son descartadas. Hablo de subjetividades no heteronormativas, racializadas, generizadas, etc., que sirven solo cuando logran ser capitalizadas como tendencias. El territorio no es un lugar remoto, ni está habitado por nadie, como en la moda, sino que está vivo. The coloniality is there. It just is. And it does so not as an option, but as an inevitable mode of existence, an existence that has always been there, but empty of meaning, by the modern colonial gaze of fashion. Existences that resist and re-exist. What is in collision is not the struggle between fashion and a new fashion, but other horizons of meaning to relate to clothing from subjectivities that, like clothes, are discarded. I'm talking about non-heteronormative, racialized, gendered subjectivities, etc., which are only useful when they manage to be capitalized as trends. The territory is not a remote place, nor is it inhabited by anyone as in fashion, but it is a lie. So we don't have so much time, and I would like to start immediately with the director. I would like to start with the first video, a fashion editorial in the fashion garbage dump. Paula?
I'm very glad to be here, and I'm very happy that you can saw the fashion film. Because it's really, really amazing. It's a work that we are really proud. I'm talking like, and we are proud because my other colleague, that is Eric, is a photographer. He's the co-director of the fashion film. So it's an art piece that we are really proud of.
Great. Thank you, Paula. So I decided to start with this film because it's the only one that show a dystopian image.
Mm-hmm.
Today there is a lot of writing and conference talking about possible futures, imaginary possible futures, better futures. So I see that what we see in the video is the most possible future, is the present future. So I also think something that also take my attention is the colonial ways, the concept of colonial ways that appear in this film, and that actually Francesco put that in the chat too in the beginning of the event today. So I see that I'm interested in how we get used to this kind of images, how we are disaffected by images. And I need to say that everything that is happening with Palestine, with the occupation and the genocide, has to do with that as well. How social media use images to increase audience, to finally don't care about the life of other people in order to just provoke something. So I would like to ask you, Paula, what do you think about the glamorization of tragedy? Because I know there is a lot of interest in the Atacama Desert because of what is happening now with the clothes. So how you relate with that? Because there is a lot of people that want to do project there, but you know, it's a social, humanitarian, ecological problem. It's not something to glamorize in some way.
Yeah, of course, as you were telling, there's an intention of that the passion film is like that, because Sarita Rodriguez as a project is a satirized idea of fashion at this point, Sarita Rodriguez, the first one was an art presidency. And at that point, we tried to fantasize with the idea of have a fashion store as a fashion store, like the glamour one, the one you could find, I don't know, in London, for example. But this one, it's a national fund. So, of course, it involves another type of story. And in our case, as Chile, we have the fashion dump. So, we keep going working with the fashion language to show the destroy of the of fashion in our territory. And that's the main idea of doing a fashion film in that place, because that's the decolonial approach that we take with Eric to show our art and specifically to talk about fashion in our country. So for us, the decolonial approach involves taking the code of fashion, its entire language and aesthetic, to showcase all the devastating effects that it's having right now. While this could seem colonial for trying to showcase it like that, but of course it's not, because we are talking specifically about this. Why this image try to be this and doesn't look like this? Because it's not like that. We can be like that, because we are not like that. And that was a lesson that I get personally in another art project that is called 15 Minutes of Fame. That is long story short, it's a fashion set in the street to take images of people to make a fashion magazine. and trying to find something spectacular. Of course, we didn't find nothing spectacular because the idea of a spectacular is what I think I could find in Europe or, I don't know, in the USA. And that was a really humble lesson for me because I was trying to find something that I will never find here because we are not like that. So this expectation to find something doesn't exist simply because we are here in Chile, in Latin America. And of course, that's the purpose of the fashion film, to try to find something that you can never going to find because it doesn't happen that. And it's not going to happen because the fashion world have decided that in that part of the country or in the world specifically, we're going to have a dump. So that's the reason that we try to use that image to provoke specifically this type of dystopia, even in the image and even in what it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Paula. Thank you. I'm thinking that with these colonial ways, it's like, okay, we receive all of these colonial ways and we need, and we are responsible to do something with that, you know, to maybe maybe we want to do another project, but we say, okay, but maybe this is more important, you know, it's something somebody put the problem we need to address, you know, as yes, designer, as creator, I don't know. Okay, so I'm going to pass to the second director just because
Thank
we don't
so
have
much.
Enough time. I
no,
would like
okay.
to continue the conversation, but for me, it was very important to ask you about the glamorizing tragedy. Tragedy. Okay, so the second one is Entangled by Kaya.
Yes,
I'm going to address this question to you because I know it's like to your topic. So as the director is not here, I'm going to ask you something. It's okay?
Okay, I will try to answer, yes. By
okay.
the way, Kaya was my student, so to some extent, I know her work.
Okay, perfect. So... okay, as you notice, we passed from a dystopian image to a dream landscape. So for me, it was very important to show the contrast. Okay, there is lots of about new materialism in this fashion film. How, for example, the centering the human being and breaking the hierarchy of the human being and the things. Also, Bruno Latour's notion of reassembling our agency entangled with that of object, the construction of our subjectivity and of things at the same time. So Francesco, how thinking of things as political agents and not inanimate things might allow us to imagine more ecological and sustainable futures? How thinking of things as political agent and not as inanimate things, dead things, might allow us to imagine more ecological and sustainable futures? How if we think that the things in the world, you know, not just us, I mean, you know, the tree, the table, have their own agency, can change the way we produce things.
Yeah, yes.
How we relate to things.
Thank you. Yes, yeah, I understand. Well, I think in a way, this points to an important shift from human-centered design that has actually caused anthropocentrism and to a vision, a paradigm of more than human. And in a way, I think in fashion, we have often felt, well, in society, we often are disconnected from nature. And instead, we need to really embrace our interconnectedness with nature or entanglement, as you say. And I think we are nature. And I think if we really embody that philosophy that we are nature and we are fashioned from nature, I think hopefully we can contribute to a more sustainable and ecological future, as you say. So yeah, considering not the detachment between things and us, but things as political agents, as you say, but also considering the interrelationships between ourselves and nature and the more the human world, I think that will contribute to a radical shift towards sustainability, if it makes sense.
Thank you, Francesco. Thank you so much for answering and for your thought. Now I would like to pass to video call to fashion. Abraham Os Caminos and Relaciones, because I see these three films are very related among them. I think we came from nature, from outside to a more personal space, personal history. In these videos, I also see that the past as the present is very like important, that idea. And see the past not just only that we need to overcome, but as something that guides us. Like here, all again, subjectivity and object as a simultaneous constructions is very important, that idea in the film. Okay, Dori, so I would like to ask this question. How these clothes are filled with the subjectivity of the people that wear them? How these other ways of existence through clothing are a mode of everyday resistance? This is something that for me captured my attention, because I can see a very natural way of sustainability, but also a daily resistance in some way. How these people construct the relationship with objects, with clothing, is completely in some way out of fashion. So do you think this is a kind of daily protest or a way of resistance?
No, I don't. I see the object of the series of films, because there are these are two of 12. The idea behind them really was to think differently about fashion. So moving the thinking about fashion as a noun to an act of fashioning yourself, of fashioning your identity. So I don't see it as a resistance. I see it much more as a, I suppose, looking at the power of clothing and dress to give expression to your identity, to who you are. New Zealand, Aotearoa, it is a country with of migrants, of immigrants, so it's very, very, very diverse, and I suppose it's sort of an anti-fashion statement in a way, in that sort of claiming, I suppose, the permission to fashion yourself in your own way and not be dictated to.
Okay,
but I don't see it as a resistance, as an activism against anything, but much more I see it much more positively as a
but I'm talking actually outside of activism, because I see that, for example, the first video where the lady were taking care of the clothing, of course it's easier to go to the shop and to buy something, you know, rather than take the time to make your clothes. I see this also as a way of resistance. Maybe not the idea we have about activism, protest in the street, but in my thinking, I see as a little act of daily resistance. This is my opinion, but I respect, of course, your opinion too. And I would like to ask the director of relations, I would like to ask you same question about the hat, about also thinking that in Peru and in Bolivia too, as country with a lot of indigenous population that migrate from the countryside to the cities, you know, there is also more possibilities to buy other kind of clothes, not use their ethnic clothes. You know, I don't like to say traditional because I think it doesn't have any movement, that word, so I don't like that word, to refer to indigenous people or people with some indigenous origin. So do you see that to use ethnic clothes in the city, for example, if it can be a kind of resistance today?
I mean, when I was there in Huaraz, this hat that you saw comes from a city called Huaraz in the mountains of Peru, or at the feet of the mountains of Peru. And when I was there, what I perceive is that people are not thinking on resistance. I think this resistance in the city. Rural activities or people that lives in the rural areas that come to the city is very natural, is very normal, is part of the visual landscape. So mm-hmm. people from the city also, as you, the people that were talking were like the grandchildren, and they are used to see people wearing these clothes. So I'm not sure if the people themselves do it for resistance. It's more a natural thing. But I do think if we talk about the capital, that is Lima, I think it is definitely someone that wears these clothes is a type of let's say resistant. It's a matter of asking them as
yes,
well.
Yes, maybe maybe the word is not so precise, but do you understand? You know that something there.
I ask a lot of people there. There was one woman that works in the central market of Huaraz, and I asked her about her clothes, and she told me, I went to Lima and I went to work in a house as a domestic help for help. And she told me, and the persons there wanted me to wear other clothes and, you know, to put like a sort of uniform. And for her, it was a way of erasing her identity or trying to just impose her something that she's not. And she was very, very sure when she told me, you know, and this is not myself, and I am not going to let someone impose something on me. That's why she went back to Huaraz, and she's working in the market, in the restaurant, and having her restaurant there. And there you notice this kind of resistance. Mm-hmm. And I think Huaraz is maybe the younger people. There was also these students studying a university, and they told me about one guy that went to the university with his clothes. When it comes to younger generations, and they go to the university they don't call it traditional, they call it more habit, their habitual clothes. This is a way of resistance. When everyone in your really close environment, I think especially younger generations are like looking at you with bad eyes, let's say, I don't know, then I think it's resistant. But in general, in the city, it's mm-hmm. more part of the landscape, visual landscape. Mm-hmm. Yeah, natural. Yeah.
Thank you, Brenda. It's so,
yes.
Yeah, it's so interesting to see that people even if they suffer discrimination,
yes.
You know, because they are wearing these clothes, they still want to use them because they are part of the sense of belonging. So
yes.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
I would like to ask same question to the director, to Marcel Márquez.
Sí, sí, es una manera de resistencia, ¿no? Vestirse así, bueno, lo que me viene a la cabeza ahora para responderte es que la verdad es que no, porque la lucha y la resistencia, ella sigue aconteciendo desde siempre, ¿no? Aquí en Brasil es desde 1500, empezó la lucha y la resistencia de varias maneras. Y este fecho fin es un intento de decir lo que somos de verdad, ¿entiendes? Y no lo que la media dice de lo que es Brasil, lo que deja de ser Brasil. Entonces, el brasileño, y creo que la mayoría de Sudamérica, tiene ahí varios estigmas, estereotipos, que dicen, que quieren decir lo que es ser brasileño, y eso no es lo que somos en realidad. Y entonces yo, a partir de una búsqueda y una pesquisa de las raíces de las religiones afro-brasileñas, ¿no? Umbanda y Candomblé, traje las inspiraciones de las vestimentas de los orixás en todas esas ropas, ¿no? Y entonces, por ejemplo, la primera ropa es un homenaje así a las baianas, que son las baianas, las mujeres del siglo XVIII, XIX, que son una gran imagen de moda, así, de la época y colonial brasileña. Y yo traje esos vestidos como con fajas, ¿no? Varias fajas que son entre telas, así, que yo las fui cosiendo una a una. Y después, ¿no? De eso, hice como si fueran el resto de las faldas de esas baianas, vistiendo nuevamente nuevos cuerpos ahora. Entonces, bueno, lo que quiero decir así en resumen es eso. Busqué una manera de traer para ahora, de pensar ahora nosotros que aún vivimos de esa cultura y buscamos de esa cultura y nos inspiramos de eso. ¿Cómo sería esa imagen ahora? ¿Cómo sería eso ahora? Y es eso lo que visteis.
Sí, muchas gracias. Me encanta tu comentario porque complejiza la conversación. Respecto, una cosa es que me parece súper interesante esto que tú mencionas, que finalmente nosotros hemos estado en resistencia, o sea, como que no es resistencia mantener lo que ha sido siempre, ¿me entiendes? Me gusta esta contradicción también de, en mi caso, veo que en eso hay una resistencia, pero tú tienes mucha razón también que finalmente eso es lo que siempre ha sido. Entonces, ahí hay algo que a mí me hace pensar. So, I'm going to translate, sorry. I was saying, Marcel, that it's very important his opinion because he said that he doesn't see resistance in those practices, in those clothes, because it has been always like that. You know, it has been 500 years of being in the world in that way. So I'm completely agree as well. So for me, as I like to complicate things and I like to think from contradictions, I think it's very interesting because I can see in the use of the hat in for example, a kind of resistance. A kind of resistance against discrimination, violence, all those kind of things. But I'm agreeing with Marcel that, okay, but which is the resistance if everything has been like that? I need to read this one. Because Sandra Nielsen was talking about if fashion and the coloniality is a fashion. Okay? Do you remember? And there is a very important decolonial thinking, feminist thinker from Latin America, Silvia Rivera Cusicanqui, who like 8 years ago said in a conference in Mexico about decoloniality, about subaltern thought in Latin America, said that no fashion, decoloniality is a fashion. I'm going to say in English and I'm going to read in Spanish. She said that the colonial is a fashion, the post-colonial a desire, and the anti-colonial a struggle. And I wanted to say this right now because of the answer of Marcel. She said, I think it is a way of highlighting the fact that this process has a long history. Since colonial times, there have been processes of anti-colonial struggles. On the other hand, the decolonial is a very recent fashion that, in a way, usufructuate and reinterpret those processes of struggle. But I think it lost its politics. Since the decolonial is a state or a situation, but it's not an activity, it does not imply an agency.
nor a conscious participation. I put the anti-colonial struggle into practice every day, in a way, delegitimizing all form of reification and the ornamental use of the indigenous by the state. I think it's important to think also about the coloniality in the academia, because for me, something that happened is that in the relocation of the colonial practice of resistance into theory, sometimes it loses something. I wanted to share this. Thank you. Okay, so now, because we don't have more time, I'm gonna pass to the last video. I remember Maria Galindo, another amazing a figure of feminism, decolonialization in Latin America. She's an anarcho-feminist from Bolivia. And Maria Galindo says, if the problem is power, in the face of power, you don't empower yourself, you rebel. And I saw that in the video. I love the way you express how the protagonists express how they felt more happy, you know, but they didn't use the word I empowerment, you know. So I like that they try to avoid that. From a book of Maria Galindo, the book is called Feminismo Bastardo. Bastard feminism, she proposed the notion of intuitive feminism, which emerged from the capacity of women outside of activism or the academia that read their own history, and from the recognition of their own struggle, they are able to articulate a feminist discourse. So I would like to ask Talita if she see this kind of intuitive feminism in the woman of the video, how they became political subject in some way through the use of clothing, through the appropriation of the clothes.
Boa tarde a todos e todas. Eu não prego a política do feminismo no Transmutações do Feminino, tanto porque como o projeto acontece em periferias da cidade de São Paulo, existem outras camadas que vêm à frente da política do feminismo, que é a questão da resistência e da sobrevivência, sobretudo. Então, o projeto Transmutações Feminino leva a consultoria de moda e o ensaio fotográfico para que essas mulheres, por meio de suas vestimentas, os adornos, e também de se ver na frente das câmeras, consiga, de alguma forma, melhorar a autoestima, voltar a viver, porque muitas delas têm histórias, narrativas femininas muito complexas e pesadas por conta das vulnerabilidades sociais, econômicas, nos seus territórios. Então, acredito, gostei muito dessa palavra do feminismo intuitivo, porque ele não é pregado, mas ele é sentido de alguma forma, né? Então, a gente não fala sobre essa política em si, então a gente atua. E sobre o empoderamento, a gente segue uma linha de raciocínio que vem de uma escritora brasileira, Joyce Bert, que fala sobre empoderamento a partir dos coletivos, né? Então, nosso empoderamento acontece quando nós, mulheres, regamos esse feminino, fazemos essa reconexão acontecer, e aí a gente se empodera se ajudando, se fortalecendo, escutando as histórias uma das outras, se vendo, partilhando essas conquistas. Então, Transmutações Feminino acontece mais ou menos dessa forma durante os encontros.
So she said greetings for everyone. So she says she doesn't apply the idea of feminism because they're all from women from the São Paulo outskirts, where there's so many other layers to be addressed. So even though, so because they work in the resistance and the survival, but in their daily lives. So what the project does is the project offers a fashion consultancy where through clothes, accessories, and other textile materials, they can see themselves better and created a feminine narrative. So where the struggle of economic, social class, and other things can be a way to demonstrate resistance, right, and for that survival. She thinks, or she liked it as the way the feminism intuitive was employed, because she feels that she thinks that this is the way, because she doesn't apply the feminist, but she feels that feminism is there. And they have in mind, in back of their minds, that a Brazilian author called Joyce Dart, where they work through the reconnection, the idea of help each other, listening and sharing, and the idea of exchange power. Not power, right? But this mm-hmm. Brazilians. And,
Thank you so much, Talita. I do agree that sometimes feminisms with S, because there is not just one feminism from my perspective, feminisms. I see feminism as a beyond struggle between gender, this kind of thing. I see more a social movement. So I'm completely happy with what you say about that. Is there, there is, you know, but maybe we should not call like a feminist perspective. We can talk about this collaboration, this space of sorority in a different way. So thank you so much.
Thank you,
everyone. It's very late, so we have to finish here. Thank you to the director for your thoughts. Thank you, Francesco, for replying the question in the absence of the director. Sorry for the technical problem we had today. I know you had put so much effort and love in your work, so sorry about that. I'm afraid that we don't have more time to open the conversation. Thank you so much. I invite you to think about fashion, decoloniality, how we are addressing this conversation too, because it's very complex. Today, maybe I was politically incorrect in quoting Silvia Rivera Cusicanqui, but I think this is a very contradictory space. It's full of conflict in so many layers. So I would like to keep the conversation with the research collective for decoloniality and fashion, because I do believe that they do a great work, because they start putting this subject into so many space, and I know they put a lot of effort to disseminate collaboration through different places. So even if I say this kind of thing sometimes, I'm happy that we have the possibility at least to talk about that. Thank you so much, everyone.
Of course. Thanks so much. Thanks for coming. Thanks for joining us. I hope to see you, everyone, in different activities here and there, CGF, our community.